So guys, welcome to this webinar. My name is Komal and I am a co-founder and content head for Lossyco. Just want to check, am I audible to everyone clearly? Yeah, brilliant. Okay, so today's topic seems a little bit like a question in itself, but we're going to be talking about compliance as a career for law students. Now the way it works is that compliance is considered, there's a very different idea about what compliance really means among the people. Like, the popular idea about compliance is very different. Okay, so we are going to have a look at what it really means and what are the things that you actually include in compliance, what are the kind of traits that you would need in order to develop a career in compliance, and why is it relevant, right? So we have a couple of hands raised, Namrata and P. Jovai. Whatever questions you have, it will be great if you can put them down in the chat. And we are going to be taking the questions a little bit later. Does that work with everyone? Yeah? Does that work with everybody? Okay, brilliant. Just put your questions down in the chat. And like, we can have a look at the questions as we go along. So let us begin this this webinar actually with an incident. I have shared this incident before in my writing, but I would like to share with all of you guys. And this is actually a true incident. This really happened with me. So let me bring you to that incident. Okay. So this was like kind of many years back when I was studying law. So one of my professors kind of conducted a survey in the class, right? So, and the question that he asked or he put through was, what do you want to be? Okay. Do you want to be a lawmaker, a law follower, or a lawbreaker? Okay. So he was just putting, like, taking people's votes and marking them right on the board itself, right? So when he did that, most of the people in the class chose to be a lawbreaker. And just remember this, we were in a class, we were studying law. And in this survey, there were so many people who chose to be a lawbreaker, okay? Followed by the people who chose to be lawmakers, and very few people chose to be a law follower. Why do you think this was the case? What would you choose to be? Let me have some views here. If you were asked to be a lawmaker, a law follower, or a lawbreaker, what will you choose to be? Lawmaker. Okay. One vote for lawmaker. What else? What about the rest of the people? Lawmaker. Why would you choose to be a lawmaker? Rahul, Ananya? Why do you want to be a lawmaker? Anyone who wants to be a lawbreaker? Don't worry, these stats are not going to be visible in the videos or something that we put up. And we can just, like, have a very informal discussion here. It is not going to draw anything for you. Okay. So what would you choose to be? I'm telling you that in a law class, so many of the people chose to be a lawbreaker. Okay. So, It was like, a revelation to the professor itself. He was so confused about the response that he actually took a step back and he asked, are you really understanding what I'm asking here. Okay. And the people got it. Okay. So because there are many laws needed, for example, for cryptocurrency, which are not coming through. Okay, there are laws required which are not coming through. So you want to be a lawmaker and actually have laws for that. Okay. What else? What about the rest of the people? Fine, law breaking will never end, so law making will continue. That is actually what happens, isn't it? So you find all the time that there are people who break the law. And then after that, in order to plug that and in order to stop that things from happening, you have law which comes in. Okay. And this is the precise reason actually why the people in the class chose to be lawbreakers. Okay. So in their mind, lawbreakers was not being someone who was violating the law, but it was to be someone who identified where there were gaps in the law and took benefit of it. So everyone wanted to be in that zone. They felt that they would be a step ahead of the people who made the law. Okay, because then the lawmakers would have to follow and actually make new law to stop that loopholes or to plug it. Okay, so that's the reason why everyone was choosing to be a lawbreaker, right? Exactly, that's how you see amendments come again and again, Rahul. That's what is happening. So this is what the natural tendency of the people is, never to comply with something they are asked to. Okay. So most people will not want to comply. They will not want to follow the rules. Okay. So either they break it completely and it results into a violation, or they identify a loophole or a gap. Okay. That's how it happens. And then ambitious entrepreneurs who want to conquer the world. And like the feeling is that if you are imposing law on me, you are actually trying to restrict me and control me. I am not going to be restricted or controlled by you. I'm going to identify where there is a gap or a loophole, and I'm going to go about, like, you know, working with that. Okay. So this is what the tendency is. So then why are we talking about compliance? You know, compliance on that, it will seem as compliance is someone who is following the law. Like, you know, you are putting your fingers on your mouth and you are just doing as you are asked to do. Okay, where is the charm in that? Or why are we talking about that as a career then? Right? That is the question. Because the popular understanding of compliance is follow the law. And that is not the only thing that compliance is about. It does not simply mean to follow the law. Okay? Now, when we are talking about identifying loopholes, or when we are talking about identifying gaps in the law, remember that you have systems in your business. Okay? The exact way where you are actually looking to take a benefit of law by identifying the gaps and the loopholes in the law, there can be someone who identifies the gap or the loophole in your business systems and takes the benefit of it. Okay? So this is an oft-heard saying: you do not rise up to the level of your goals, you fall to the level of your systems. So you have systems which are inadequate. In some cases, you do not have any kind of systems at all, or you have like hastily put together systems where things are not thought of, okay, properly. There will be people internally and externally who take a benefit of this, and they like, you know, take an advantage. Okay. And I would say that there are many cases where you have like internal people. Okay. I would like to quote particularly the situations, I would like to talk about situations which happens in small businesses. Many medium and small businesses do not have proper systems. So they don't have written down documents. They don't have things which are put into records properly. And then there is this kind of thing that, okay, XYZ is such a senior level employee. So how can you think that, you know, this person is going to do something wrong? And in so many cases, you have people who are at the top of a system, who have been most reliable over a period of time, actually take the benefit of these systems, identify the gaps, and, you know, actually they cause a great loss to the business. They defraud the business. They take advantage of it. Okay. They kind of cheat. And then it is only because they can do it. Okay. Now they are at such a level and they have identified that they can do this. Okay. So if someone wants to identify and someone wants to really be in the zone of compliance, they will really identify situations like this, that where can someone take the benefit? Where can someone be in a situation where there is a loophole? They will be working one step ahead of the people who can take any kind of benefit and fixing the systems accordingly. Any questions? Yeah, legal cheating, it can be. Because they identified, they have seen that there is a gap in your business systems. Now you are out to make money and earn, generate a lot of business by doing the hard work. And there's a gap in your own system itself. And no entrepreneur or management would like to leave the systems vulnerable enough for someone to benefit at the cost of the company. Okay. Nobody in the world wants this to happen. Okay. Everyone wants to gain more profits. Everyone wants to gain more sales. Everyone does not like to be restricted by the law, but no one wants systems like this that they are taken benefit of or advantage of by someone else. Okay. So this is one thing that is very important, and a really tiny system leak can cause a big dent in all the hard work that you have been putting in to expand and generate revenue. So you are doing all the work to actually earn a lot of profits for the business, generate revenue, increase sales, all of those, you are bringing it and putting it into a pot. And then someone, just one, puts a tiny leak in that pot. Okay. No one wants that to happen. And it can cause a big problem for you because you are doing all the hard work and someone just is able to take the benefit with that tiny leak. Someone is raising a hand. If you have any points, guys, please put it down in the chat. Okay. A compliance miss can cost heavily. Okay. So, and now just think of, you know, what happens in terms of missing some compliance requirements or having gaps. This is what happens. This is a 2019 news where Google was fined euro 50 million for GDPR violation in France. Okay. And the way that happened is there were four clauses of GDPR which got violated, where it was taking or gathering some kind of data, okay, for the people. This was in January 2019, okay. And now let's look at more recent news, and it's a record break for, like, we are kind of, you know, used to hearing cases where the likes of Google or Facebook or all of this are taken to task across the world for different kind of things, because these entities operate with data, right? So it's likely. But what about this entity? Goldman Sachs. It's a very, very reputed name. Okay. If people, you have heard about this before 2020, if you read this news here, it had never pleaded guilty in any financial crime. Okay. And that is in its 151 year old history, it has never, been caught or considered guilty in any financial crime. Okay. But now when that happened, it happened such that they were fined US dollars 2.9 billion. Okay, and this was because of 1 MDB. 1 MDB is Malaysia Development Berhad. That was like a government scheme where they were collecting bonds, they were issuing bonds, and the funds of that scheme were kind of misappropriated and used for bribery and for, you know, giving luxurious things, assets, creating luxurious assets for political people, okay, government authorities. So this is what happened. And then, you know, the fine was not only this, they were also considered to be violation of the FCPA, US Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. Okay, so this happens when you have, like, you know, you haven't had system which is proper enough, and there is some little gap left in the system. Otherwise, the likes of Goldman Sachs, as we are saying, never pleaded guilty to a financial crime in a 151-year-old history. Okay. But now when it happens, it's a huge fine and it's a blot on the reputation, the cost of which cannot be calculated. Okay. So these things can happen. So now, like, when you think we think that compliance is following the law, it's just following the law. Okay, so let us look at what compliance actually involves. I already spoke about systems, but let's look at what it really involves. What is the groundwork that, you know, someone in compliance would be involved with? Okay, or when can you say that it's compliance related work? This is the number one, contract execution. Now, you drafted a watertight contract, but what now? How do you get it signed, stamped, registered? Does it need an apostille? Okay. You review and draft contracts. You make it really fantastic. It's like just amazingly drafted. But what point it is if you do not know exactly how it should be executed? And until you get it done and dusted, you actually get it signed, you actually get it stamped, registered, and it's everything completed for it to be effective. Okay. This is what is compliance. So many times we will see that, you know, legal will be very keen on identifying how the clauses can be fixed, how everything can be sorted. And then this is where there will be a miss. There will be one signature missing. Okay. The stamping requirement can be inadequate. It needs a postal to be effective in another country. That will be something that's not done until the last point of time. So these kind of situations can happen. Now, even if you put all your legal skills to use, what use it is unless you ensure this compliance and get it done and dusted and recorded. Okay. So you have to see it completed and finished. That's what compliance is. Contract implementation. This is missing in just innumerable cases. Okay, so you got it drafted, you got it executed, you got everything completed. Have you noted what are the points in that contract which need to be implemented on a regular basis? One indication is this, information covenants. Okay, so many contracts require that periodically X information needs to be given to Y. Like, you know, it has all information related covenants. How many of these provisions do you think are complied with? Okay. Is the information going to the person at the proper time? Are the reports, if it requires that certain reports or details are given to a person, is that happening on a regular basis? Very few people are up to ensuring these kinds of things happen. Okay. And at the last, like, you know, minute when everything needs to be checked and when there is a dispute and when things need to be taken to court, like, you will have this provision that you don't even have sufficient information in order to proceed with this because the information covenants in the contract were never followed and you did not enforce it. Okay. To you, payment is coming. That is enough. But the information covenants that you put in it, it's not being followed. So contract implementation, a huge lag, huge lag. okay. Policy, system and process development to ensure no legal violations and contract implementation. So now you have to ensure that your policy is developed in consonance with the law that you are subject to and in consonance with the contracts that you have entered into. Okay, you have to ensure that there are appropriate processes in place. Okay, so for example, let us assume that you are at the other end of this information covenant. It's not just you receiving it which matters. If you have to provide and someone comes at you after a breach, they will come with all clauses of breach. Okay, they are not going to catch you just that, you know, you didn't make the payment. They will say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all of these clauses were breached because you didn't follow and you didn't comply with these points. Okay, so therefore, if you are at the other end, it's your job to develop a system inside the business that this specified information or the specified clauses which are not related directly maybe to payment are complied with. Okay, so many times this happens in cases where it is a small business and it is started by family or by friends. Okay, at that point of time, everything is white and everything is gold. People will be in this zone that, wow, my friend or my brother and sister and everybody are like, you know, so cooperative and we are doing this business together and it's going to be successful and everything is fantastic. Okay, everything is white, everything is white. At certain point of time, when there are disputes, disagreements, people literally come at the throat of each other. And at that point of time, everything that is not done, okay, all board meeting notices that are not issued, all documents that are not completed, all these things which seem really petty will come into picture, okay, and be clubbed together to prove that XYZ didn't do their job or to bring it all into a dispute. Everything will be put together into that dispute. At that point of time, it will not be just the business related things which will be questioned, right? So you have to ensure that the policy, system and process development is really solid to ensure that there are no legal violations and that there is contract implementation as required. Anyone has any questions up to this point? Is what I am discussing here making sense? Say yeah, if it is making sense to you. I want to know the response from people. Does this resonate? Does this resonate? Only two people. Come on, some responses. I want to see that you are actually getting it. Yeah. Brilliant. Okay, let's move to the next point. Yes, great. Identifying system leaks and fixing them promptly. This is another thing. Always in businesses, you kind of have things where you fix what is called an accountability. It's not responsibility. It is where you fix accountability on someone. Okay. So you have to think that at what points, who is accountable for what? Okay. It's not responsible. So whom do you hold to account? Who is supposed to get certain things done? At every point of time in a system where there is a compliance that you need to get done, you have to identify who is an accountable person. Okay. And at each point where there are leaks or where there are gaps, you have to identify what is the leak in the system. And you have to identify who is accountable at that point of time to get something done. And you have to ensure that it is fixed up and that they take up their accountability. Okay. Otherwise, in a corporate atmosphere, it is very easy to pass the buck, as we say. People will say, I passed it, and then XYZ didn't approve over email. And XYZ has 1,000 emails in his inbox. They didn't even see it. So it's a lapse like this. But you have to fix, if you fix accountability, that it's your job to get this done. Okay? Then it will be that person who takes it, and you can fix the system leaks at that point of time. Ensuring superb database and record management. It looks boring, it looks admin, but like I said, when you do not have enough information and when you do not have proper record keeping on things, you can be taken to task at a point when there is a dispute that arises and when there is a litigation. Because at one point of time, you will be required, you know, your lawyer or yourself, you will require to bring something to the court. And it is at that point of time, you will be rummaging everywhere in the office for that specific record and trying to like call up people and get everything done at the last minute. Okay. This is the kind of situation you will fall into if the database and record management is not proper. Okay. And on the other hand, if you ensure this, if you ensure that there is a fantastic record management, okay, database and everything is fantastically available at any point of time, even when you commit a violation, okay, you will be able to bring this to a specific regulator or a court and say that, look, normally our systems are like this. And we have tried to identify to ensure that, like, you know, everything is complied with. Okay, you can see the records. We have tried to get everything in line. It is just a one-off occasion that this thing happened. And the court will make sense of that. Okay, they will realize that the culture in the company is a systematic culture and is that of compliance. And that the miss is a one-off. Okay, your penalty can be reduced accordingly. So this is very important, ensuring superb database and record management. And last but not the least, of course, ensuring that your regulatory submissions happen on time and, like, you know, they are taken care of by the right kind of people. The right information reaches the right people on time. Okay. Now, why can this work as a career for law students? So why, like, you know, why is this better done or why can this be better handled by law students? Why would law students be the right people or why would lawyers be the right people to take this off? Okay. How can you think of it as a career? Everything in a business happens through transactions. Okay. And transactions require contracts. Okay. So all the time when you have a transaction, you will need a contract. So because you draft and review the contracts, that's why you are perfectly placed to identify the implementation points. You have drafted the information covenant. Okay. You have drafted the requirement to have a notice in a particular manner. You have drafted that it must reach the specific person, this identified person at this time. You have drafted that it requires a 7 or a 14 days notice to do something. So you are the person to identify what should be the implementation point in a contract. Okay? You have drafted it to know whether there is an indemnity in the contract. So you know what is the kind of stamping that contract is going to need. Okay? Which is why you are the best person for contract execution and implementation. And I will tell you, loads of people lag on this. Okay. They believe that drafting is the be all end all. It isn't. Okay. So you are best placed to identify what are the implementation points to ensure that everything goes according to that contract. Lawyers are naturally trained to think of what if something goes wrong, okay, what can go wrong? So you are kind of thinking that what if this happens? What if this goes wrong? What if this changes? Okay, it's just a trait of a lawyer to think of what can be the wrong thing that is going to happen. Okay, always looking at downsides, always thinking at what can be a problem here. So you use these skills or this sense to develop a rock solid system for a business. And you find out that what can go wrong here. Find out what can now go wrong, and then you fix it. So like that, you develop like really good processes and systems and thinking that whatever is going to go wrong should be taken care of in that system. Okay, it's just a natural sense that lawyers have. Now you know that a submission needs to reach a regulator by a specific date, like I was saying. So you are the best person to calculate backward, okay, and build an input processing output system towards the compliance. Okay, so you know that it has to be submitted, let's say, on certain website electronically by this date. Now you will identify backward from that who is going to submit that. So until when does that information need to reach him? Who is going to provide that information to him? And in order to provide that information, what are the kind of inputs that person will need? So you work backwards. How much time the middle guy will need to process? How much time the first person will need to gather inputs from different places? Okay, you are the right person to work backward from this and work out what is the system that you need to install. Okay, so you can be sure this. As lawyers, we are also trained to generate evidence, and I can tell you that it is incredibly crucial. Okay, you study and you must have read all of the instances that happens. Every single thing needs to be in writing. Okay, you cannot, like, we are trained, like as lawyers, we are kind of trained that oral contracts are not really contracts as such, because where do I get the evidence for it? Okay, we are trained to think of generating evidence in all things. Okay, so we will take this attitude always. We are perfectly suited for compliance in this situation to think that everything needs to be in writing. Every receipt needs to be acknowledged. Now, I've held one position, for example, it was with a bank, and the internal audit was so tough that they would even keep a record of the discussions that you have between like different people in the same department. I had to have, like, I will have discussions with my manager inside our cabin. So these will only be oral discussions, right? But then I have to come out and I have to email the point of that discussion to myself as a record that on this day, this is what I discussed with my manager. It is so crazy. Okay. But that is the level of record keeping entities which are dealing with a lot of money. Like, you know, as you saw, Goldman Sachs, who are subject to anti-money laundering kind of violations, data related violations. Okay, all these entities will need this kind of record keeping. Okay, because they have to trace everything down to the last level for everything. And I can tell you how important this is. I have held a position where I was dealing with a public issue. Okay, and we were dealing with a lead manager. And there was a certain contract that needed to reach the lead manager. Okay, there was an agreement which needed to reach the lead manager. Now, what happened is one day they are certainly like I had sent it to them, and they are suddenly sitting up and they are telling the management that we have never received this contract. Okay, they were just up and they were telling the management we have not received it. So now it was such a crucial contract that literally my job would have been under threat. Okay, but I had seen the sense enough to get it hand delivered to them and then get a stamp of received on a copy of that contract with me. Okay. Otherwise, they simply stood up and said, we have never received it. Okay. But I had gotten it hand delivered and I got the stamp of received on a copy of that contract with me. I had specifically instructed the person who was hand delivering that get a stamp of received on this date and sign, and then bring the copy back to me. So at that time, I was able to say that I have a copy with your received stamp on it. Now, how are you saying that we never got it? So after that, they couldn't speak anything because I maintained that record. If I hadn't kept this, and if I had been lax enough to just send it in some manner, I would have been on the verge of losing my job. It is so crucial. Okay. So record keeping, keeping things in writing, keeping everything that is received needs to be that needs to be acknowledged. It is very essential. In international business, business structures and transactions can be chosen on the basis of whether compliance is possible. Now you tell me, like when I begin this class of business structures, the first thing people tell me that LLP involves less compliance and private company involves more compliance than LLP. And public company involves even more compliance than the private company, which is why I will prefer to choose an LLP structure. Okay. And this is more critical in another country because you definitely do not want to end up a violator in another country. Okay. It becomes very difficult for you to manage that. Okay. The logistics itself are so crazy. You are not aware of the legal systems. You are not aware of the people. You end up a violator in another country. It's like gone. It's very difficult to mend. So as a lawyer, you are the best person to identify the extent of compliance requirements for a specific form or transaction, right? So this is why you are in a very good place to take this role. Some traits you will need if you want to succeed in the area of compliance. So what are the kind of, this is not really skills. Okay. When I say traits, it is not really skills. This is behavioral traits that you can need. Okay. So how will you, develop these traits? How do you work on this? A no exception attitude. What is a no exception attitude? Simply, you do not let anything function as an exception. Okay. All agreements need to be in writing. Means they need to be in writing. I don't care if it is with the CEO. I don't care if it is with the PUB. No exceptions. I need it to be in writing. Okay. All contracts with a supplier needs to be in a specific manner. Needs to have specific things or conditions. No exceptions. Okay. So to a compliance guy who is a really core compliance professional, it's very difficult to explain this, that, this is the reason why you create an exception of this. So then they will raise something and then they will document even why that exception was supposed to be created. Everything they will document from top to bottom. Okay. So no exception attitude. It has to be done means it has to be done. That's a compliance professional's trait. Number one trait. Others might think of you as pedantic. That compliance is taken by lot of business departments or other people. They might think that it's pedantic. Okay. But so often people will realize that when there are difficult situations, because that person acted pedantic and because that person acted in a no exception attitude, you had everything available to you. If there was any laxity at that point of time, it would have been very difficult and it would have cost. Okay, so others might think of you as pedantic. No problem. It is just required. It's a no exception attitude. And if there is an exception, it needs to be documented and communicated properly. A fix it right now attitude. Okay, so this is what happens here. For you, life is simply unacceptable until an identified system leak is fixed. Okay. So now business can think of let's drop this abhi, let us focus on earning something and leave this right now. Isko kal dekhte hai. But the compliance guy, fix it right now. Abhi. It needs to be fixed and there needs to be a solution or there needs to be something that taps or plugs that gap right now so that it doesn't happen in the next hour or even tomorrow. They are like this. So it is simply unacceptable. Until an identified system leak is fixed. Right now it needs to be fixed and installed. or else face the consequences. Well, yeah. So no, but like, you know, it, this is just a priority. Okay. People think if you look at entrepreneurs, their priority is earning, like, you know, getting more in the pot. And the compliance guy will be looking at the leak. Abhi leak ko pehle fix karna hai, baad mein we will put, like, you know, the thing in the pot. So they are like that. So life is simply unacceptable until an identified system leak is first it has to be fixed. You must be extremely good at developing processes. I told you, input, processing, output. You're going to be working back from what is the end process to what is the time required, who is accountable at that point, what does he need to do his job. And like, so view of a compliance person in many cases will be very, very comprehensive because he has a very holistic view of how things begin and how things come to an end. Otherwise, the compliance cannot be ensured. So right from the beginning up to the end, everything will be documented and everything will be like a proper process manual. Okay. So lots of people are raising the hands. Guys, please put down your comments in the chat. I will allow some questions, like I will unmute some people once we are at, you know, the end of it, which is very close. So don't worry about it. Now, you know exactly where the input is to come from, where it gets processed, where it needs to be at the right time in order to ensure that there is something that is complied with. Okay. Let me unmute Namrata. I have heard of, had a raised hand a lot of times. I'll just allow. Namrata, I have allowed you to speak. You can unmute yourself. Namrata, you can unmute yourself and speak.
Hello.
Yeah, hi, Namrata.
Hi, ma'am. Ma'am, I just want to get an example of some traits that you explained. First point, a no exception attitude. Actually, could you please explain this with an example?
Like I told you, right, that if there is an agreement that needs to be with people in the place, then that agreement will be entered into with the peon also and with the director also. No exceptions.
Okay.
Okay. So when you say, if it is like, you know, a smaller supplier and if it is a bigger supplier, they want the proper documentation for everything. Okay. Yes. So at a certain level, the invoice works. Beyond that level, there has to be a contract, and the invoice does not work means it does not work. So no exceptions.
Ma'am, just, I have one more doubt that, like, if we are, like executing any contract, suppose with the supplier, we want to supply, he has raised some purchase order with us, or like that purchase order get cancelled from the supplier end, and the contract is in the process of execution, shall we consider that or any liability on the supplier end?
So that is what I'm saying. For everything, again, there will be a process manual also. So like the other point is, you are able to identify what can go wrong. So like how you just said, you will identify that what if this happens? So if that happens, then this is the process.
Okay. Got it. Thank you.
It is all forward thought and it's all laid down and arranged in a proper manner.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Got it, ma'am.
Like how you thought, that is exactly how I'm saying, or why I'm saying that lawyers are very well placed. Because you will think of exceptions. You will think of what can go wrong. You will think of what if this happens. That's why you are the perfect person to develop a process manual. Okay? And you will cover all what ifs.
Yeah. Okay.
So this is the thing. You know exactly where the input is to come from, where it gets processed, and where it needs to be at the right time. So you will arrange, or you will go backward from that point. Now, how can LawSeco help you develop compliance skills, especially for other countries? So I wanted to share this. See, it becomes so much relevant when you are working in a situation or when you are working globally to have really appropriate compliance systems. Because just assume, like, you land up or you end up breaking the compliance requirements, or you end up breaking information requirements, or you end up breaking contracts or something in another country, okay, how difficult it can be for you while sitting in this country, because all the logistics you will have to manage accordingly. Okay, someone can sue you in that court. So now, like, you know, it is all of the problem arises that you have chosen that, and you have, when you are drafting the contract, like, you know, you may have agreed at that point of time to choose that as your governing law and jurisdiction. In all situations, you can't get your way and get, like, you know, your place as the jurisdiction. If you have negotiated and got that for yourself, then it's fine. But in a cross-border contract, if you end up having the other place as the governing law and jurisdiction, you have to be very, very careful of how things happen. Okay? So you don't know people also, and you don't know the legal systems very well also. Here you go to a court, and here you go to, like, you know, other tribunals or something. You know how the system works. You know what gets delivered to the registry, where that document passes from, where things get listed. All of these things you know. Okay, but what about the other country? Okay, so we work together and we work to develop a course where we had a lot of countries' legal systems covered in it. I just want to run that by you, because we felt that, you know, it will be very essential for situations where people are going global, left, right, and center nowadays. Okay. So this is what we put. It's a diploma in international business law, and it is developed together with Webster University. Okay. So now if you look at the syllabus of this, currently it has some 6 countries. Okay. So there is an introduction to legal systems. And then what do you know? What do you need to use? What kind of resources can you use to find out about the legal systems of a country? Because you can end up committing compliance violations unless you are very well aware of this. Okay. So cross-border contract drafting and execution, dispute resolution in terms of arbitration, and then doing business in all of these countries. So legal and court systems, how do they work? How does contract enforcement work? Okay. These are the few things where people can very easily land into trouble. FDI related issues, how to register and protect intellectual property, and then labor and employment. You can end up labor and employment violations. It is huge in other countries. Okay, like I'll tell you, I was working for a while in Ireland, and there was a Big Four firm where there was a kind of case where they were looking at and responding to candidates on an interview basis. And there was someone from an Asian region who gave an interview. Okay, and now something happened in the interview process, and he was kind of not given a proper response, while he came to know that other people were given responses. And he raised this thing that this is discrimination. Okay. And these kinds of things are taken really seriously in countries like that. Okay. And it becomes a huge blot on the reputation of the company when they are known. Even if it gets a little bit out in the media, it becomes a big problem. So labor and employment systems can become really, really strict in other countries. Okay. Owning immovable property. This is there for 6 countries currently, and we are going to increase this for a lot of different countries. Okay. So this is what this course is about. Everywhere. UAE is one destination. Dubai is one destination where most Indian businesses start their international foray from. And this is traditionally, since ages, they start, like, you know, most of them will go into the UAE region. In Dubai, particularly. Okay. So then we have Japan, Brazil. Okay. And then we have international taxation. This is another thing which is a real pain for people, because when you go off international taxation, and when you are thinking of using specific pricing mechanisms, and you have to prove that you actually use something which is called an arm's length price, there is an incredible degree of evidence or documentation that you need to maintain in order to be able to like prove that, okay, we used an arm's length price and there weren't any violations on that count. Okay. So again, something which can be fall into a hardcore compliance zone. So that is basically what that course is about. It's going to start from the 1st of March. And, you know, the faculty for this there are faculties from Webster University. There are people who are going to be from these specific regions. Either they will teach it or people who have actually managed work in those regions. These are the people who are going to teach in this course. Okay. So, like, that's what it is about. Coming back to our slides. So, we are also doing a workshop on the 19th on how to make a career in international business law. So, what are the things that will enable you to actually develop a career in this? And now is the time that you go for this, because this is the time when people have just experienced the pandemic and people have experienced that remote and cross-border work is possible. People have realized that you can actually engage people from other countries very easily. You can do business in other countries more easily than you thought was possible. Okay, all those things people have realized because of the last year that we had. And so now is the time when people are actually going to flock to go international and venture out into different jurisdictions, which is why the whole of this month, like you go to the LawSeco channel, we have focused on international business law. Okay, and we researched a lot on what are the kind of skills and what are the things people would need to know if they actually want to develop and work through a career in international business law. And that is how that course got built, right? So we are, for whole of February, this is the situation. We are going to do, like, you know, a workshop on the 19th on career in international business law. And this course actually starts from March. So, and there is no similar course. I have done a lot, me and my team, like we have done a lot of research into gathering things together, and we haven't found anything that is similar anywhere. People have raised hands. What is it that you want to ask? Yes, Nabrata, what do you want to ask? Nabrata, can I ask your question? And then Nikunj Patel, I'll allow you to talk also. Nikunj, you can unmute yourself and speak. Nabrata and Nikunj, both of you raised hands.
Hello.
Yeah, Nabrata.
Ma'am, I have done with my questions.
Okay. I saw a raised hand, that's why. Nikunj, okay. You want to ask something? I saw a raised hand there. Okay, no questions forthcoming. So we are going to do this workshop on the 19th. This is the link to join or register for this workshop. Me and Yash Vijayvargiya, who is going to anchor this course. So he is going to support the students throughout for this course. We are going to do this. Yeah, no issues. So this is the link to register for the workshop. Okay, it's entirely free and we are going to discuss how people can develop a career in international business law. Okay. So you can register for the workshop, and we have a WhatsApp group that we have created for updates on international business laws. Like I said, all this month we are focusing on this. Because like just as 2020 got over, we realized that businesses are going to make a run for going global. Okay, and this is something that is going to be a really useful skill in 2021. So this is a chat group that you can join if you want to have the updates and if you want to know about, you know, the webinars and workshops that we do in international business. I'm going to put the link for the WhatsApp group here. You can join the WhatsApp group. Okay. Anyone has any questions further on the compliance parts that we discussed, the trades that we discussed, what is involved in compliance, or anyone has any questions about the course on Diploma in International Business Law? Does anyone have any questions? We are bang at 7 p.m. here. So like I'll take any questions quickly and then we can end. Does anyone have any questions on this? Okay, how many of you are going to register for the workshop? Readings regarding today's session? It's all practice. Okay, me. Okay, Divya is registered in for the workshop. Cool. Brilliant. So see you guys there. Okay. Have a great evening and thank you so much for being there. Oh yeah. Okay. Before I end, like, I want to know what is the value you got out of today's webinar. So if you want to rate from 10, you got a lot of value. And if you're going to rate from rate 1, that means that you hardly got anything at all. So what is, like, you know, the rating that you would give for today's webinar? Please put it down. I want to see, you know, at least. Okay, Divya 8, Karun 10. Divya, why is it 8? Is there anything that you wanted or looking forward to and you didn't get? 8.5, 9. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thanks, Navrata. Brilliant. Thank you guys so much. And it can, let's look forward to compliance as a career. Thanks guys. Have a nice evening.